Hello and welcome to another exciting chemistry session. This is your host, Mr. Monsver, chemistry tutor. So as of today, we are going to start looking at the new series entitled Acids, Bases, and Salts. So for today, we'll just focus on the description of an acid only. And then in the next episode, we'll talk about bases and alkalis, and then we'll proceed. So for today, we'll just describe what an acid is. We'll describe the meaning of a weak acid, a strong acid, a dilute acid, and a concentrated acid. Then in the next chapter, we'll talk about, we'll try to describe a base, and we'll look at a weak base, a strong base, a dilute base, a concentrated base. So quickly, let's dive into details. But before we go to the description of a base, I'm sure this is not the first time you're coming across the word, an acid, sorry. This is not the first time you're coming across the word acid. I'm sure when somebody mentions an acid, something lingers in your mind. I'm sure we've watched movies before where, I can give an example of Terminator, where they have dissolved a metal. Metals are thrown in the acid and then they dissolve. So that gives us the idea about how strong acids can be. Now, using the knowledge of chemistry, we want to describe what an acid is. How can you describe an acid, or what basically makes an acid? So there are three ways in which we can describe an acid. The first one is called the Arrhenius way. We can define an acid using the Arrhenius description. We can describe an acid using the Lewis description, which is Lewis acid, Arrhenius acid. But at our level, we focus on the Arrhenius definition. So according to Arrhenius, an acid was defined as, or was described as, a chemical substance which, when dissolved in water, will produce hydrogen ions. A chemical substance which, when dissolved in water, will produce hydrogen ions. So let me just underline on the hydrogen ions as the only positively charged ion. So to make it simple for you, what they're trying to say here is that when you get this chemical substance, you dissolve it in water, what should be present microscopically in that water are hydrogen ions and other things. But for a particular substance to be an acid, there should be the presence of hydrogen ions. So microscopically, what we should be able to see is that in that container where we have dissolved that particular substance, we should be able to see hydrogen ions. And of course, there will be other things present in that container. But what is important is, if microscopically we are able to see the hydrogen ions, it means that there is a high chance that that particular substance we are dealing with is an acid. Therefore, there is an emphasis that for a substance to be called an acid, there should be the presence of hydrogen ions. We cannot have an acid that do not have hydrogen ions. So each acid should be able to liberate or release hydrogen ions. So this is a qualification. for you to be called an acid, you should be able to produce or release or liberate hydrogen ions, regardless of the quantity. Even if you produce one hydrogen ion, there's no problem. That qualifies you to be called an acid. So according to Arrhenius, an acid is a substance that, when dissolved, should be able to produce hydrogen ions. So what we have to take here is that there is no acid that do not have hydrogen ions. Each acid, or every acid, anything to be qualified to be called an acid, there should be the presence of hydrogen ions. So that is how we describe an acid using Arrhenius' description. We can move. Now, these acids are classified into two categories. We have what we call an organic acid, and we have what we call an inorganic acid. So I'm sure something crosses your mind when you hear the word organic. So something organic is something that is naturally existing. Something that is just natural is called organic. Then inorganic is something that is man-made, in short, something that we can synthesize as people. It can be deemed as inorganic, but organic is something that is naturally existing. So we have acids that naturally exist. For example, if we're going to describe an organic acid, we say an organic acid is an acid that can be extracted from living organisms. We can extract these from living organisms. They can be extracted from plants or animals. Plants or animals. Quickly, we can give an example of citric acid. It's a very common acid. Citric acid is present, Citric acid is present in citrus fruits. Of course, the chemical formula is not a problem. It's not something we should focus on. For now, we are interested in knowing the name or the names of these organic acids and where we can find them. So we're talking about citric acid. So citric acid is found in citrus fruits. So when you test a lemon, you test an orange, there's a way in which the test comes out. So because of the presence of the citric acid, it is able to give us a particular test. And then you have ethanoic acid. Ethanoic acid is present in vinegar. We have oxalic. We find oxalic in tomatoes and spinach. We have methanoic, which is known as formic acid. So methanoic acid is present in bees, wasps, and ants. So when you are stung by a bee, it's going to inject what we call the formic acid, which is methanoic acid. And that is what gives us that swelling when we are stung by these insects. We have what we call tartaric acid. Tartaric acid is present in grapes and pineapples. We have lactic acid, very common, present in sour milk. Uric acid, as usual, you find this in urine. And it gives urine a particular taste. But we are not saying that we should go and test the urine. Then we have a very interesting acid. which exist both as organic and inorganic, but they are not the same. So we have hydrochloric acid, which is found in the gastric juice. So when you're looking at digestion, to be particular, digestion of proteins, so we have what we call the oxyntic cells. Oxyntic cells will secrete hydrochloric acid, which will be present in the gastric juice, and then it's going to act on the peptic cells to activate the peptic cells. So the hydrochloric acid that is found in the stomach is totally different from the inorganic hydrochloric acid that we're going to look at in the, I think, in the next page. So those are a few. There's so many, but these are a few organic acids that we can refer to. All right. So we can move and look at inorganic. There are also plenty. In terms of inorganic acids, we're saying inorganic is the opposite of organic. So these ones are synthesized. So these are synthesized. They are extracted from minerals. And that is why in other books they are referred to as mineral acids. They are referred to as mineral acids. So we have the hydrochloric acid that we are talking about. So this one is totally different from the one which is found in the stomach. And you cannot drink this. You cannot drink this. So the one which is present in the stomach is totally different from the one that we use in the laboratory. So these are used in the laboratory. Then we have nitric acid. We have boric acid. We have sulfuric acid. Carbonic acid sometimes is optional. We have phosphoric acid, perchloric, and so on and so forth. Now, when we're looking at inorganic acids, it is also important that we know the chemical formula of these acids. So, as you can see from all the acids here, there is no acid that do not have hydrogen. And if you go back to the description of an acid, we say an acid is any substance that can be dissolved and will produce hydrogen ions. So all the acids should have hydrogen present. So it is important that we know the formulas of these acids. Let me just indicate the ones that are very important: hydrochloric acid, nitric acid, sulfuric acid, carbonic acid, phosphoric acid. It is important for all these that I have ticked. It is a must that we should know the chemical formula of these ones I have highlighted. So besides knowing the names, it's important that we also know the chemical formula. All right, so we can move and look at what is a strong acid and what is a weak acid. So when we're talking about the strength of an acid, we're looking at its ability to liberate hydrogen ions, its ability to release or to produce hydrogen ions. That is where the aspect of a strong acid and the weak acid comes in. Not every acid is strong and not every acid is weak. So what do they mean when they say a strong acid? All right. So a strong acid is the one that dissociates or ionizes. So there are key words here that we have to pay attention to. Dissociate or ionizes. So this is a process of forming ions. So when this particular acid, which is a strong acid, is in the process of forming ions, it completely or fully ionizes, and then it will produce hydrogen ions. So what do they mean when they say an acid is strong? An acid is strong when you dissolve it in water, it will dissolve completely and produce hydrogen ions. So this is a complete dissociation or complete ionization to produce hydrogen ions. Now, how do we know that this is a complete dissociation of an acid? So, a complete dissociation of an acid is always denoted by a single forward arrow. So, for example, if my acid is AB, when this dissociates, I should use a single arrow like this. So this is what represents a complete, or what denotes a complete ionization. And then, of course, I will have two ions produced. There will be a positively charged ion, and there will be a negatively charged ion. A positively charged is always hydrogen ion. Remember, in the description, we said an acid is a substance which, when dissolved, produces hydrogen ion as the only positively charged ion. So, complete dissociation is denoted by a single forward arrow. What are some of the examples of strong acids? So, mostly when you're talking about strong acids, or let me say generally, mineral acids, which are inorganic acids. Inorganic acids make perfect examples of strong acids. So the common ones are hydrochloric acid, sulfuric acid, nitric acid. So now let's look at the dissociation of these acids. How do they appear after dissociation, after forming ions? How are we supposed to represent this in a chemical equation? So this is what we're going to look at down below. So before we go to wick, okay, so complete dissociation. We made an emphasis that this is denoted by a positive, I mean, denoted by a single forward arrow. So if I have aqueous hydrochloric acid, and I should make mention this, all acids in the world exist in aqueous state. So you always see the AQ. All the acids exist in aqueous state. I'm sure you can see the AQ everywhere. All the acids exist in aqueous state. So when this hydrochloric acid undergoes dissociation, when we dissolve it in a container containing water, microscopically, we're going to see hydrogen ions and chloride ions. So what are we doing here? What we are doing here is we are just splitting the two. We are just splitting the two. And then they become H. Of course, the valence number is one. We say positive. And then chlorine, Cl, the valence number is one and negative. Now we do not write one positive or one negative, we just show positive, negative. This is the dissociation of hydrochloric acid. If we're going to look at dissociation of sulfuric acid, so So sulfuric is H2SO4. There is hydrogen and a sulfate. When this dissociates, of course, we should get hydrogen. What is its valence number? It's a 1. What is the charge? Positive. So it is always positively charged ions as hydrogen. Then a sulfate is SO4. The valence number is 2. And then it gets a negative charge. So when we are dealing with ionic equations, in ionic equations, we balance the atoms. We balance the atoms. And we balance the charges present. So when we look at this equation of sulfuric acid, dissociation of sulfuric acid, you notice that you have 2 hydrogens there, meaning to balance this, you have to put a 2 in front so that you show that you have 2 hydrogens. Then in terms of charges, this compound is neutral. The sulfuric acid is neutral. Therefore, its charge is 0. So we have to make sure that even the charge on the product side is 0, meaning 2 by positive. This means that you have 2 hydrogen ions, meaning you have a 2 positive here. Then you have a 2 negative there. 2 negative there. So when you do the math, you find that this will give you 0. So when the charge is 0, the charge is balanced, and the atoms are balanced, then the equation is balanced. When we go to dissociation of aqueous phosphoric acid, it's the same thing. So we'll split this, we'll find that we'll get the hydrogen and we'll get the phosphate. The phosphate, the valence number is 3, and then we put a negative. To balance this, because you have 3 hydrogens there, you put a 3 in front. So when you look at the charges, you'll notice that you have a positive 3 here and you have a negative 3, which when we sum up, they will give us a 0. So this is how we write what we call dissociation equations. So this is a complete dissociation when we are dealing with a strong acid. So the key words here is a strong acid is an acid that fully or completely ionizes or dissociates. Complete dissociation is denoted by a single forward arrow. Let's look at a different one, which is weak acids. How do we distinguish weak acids from strong acids? So weak acids are acids that partially ionizes or dissociates when dissolved in water, and they produce hydrogen ions. How do we know? So they are denoted by irreversible reaction arrows. These are called reversible reaction arrows. In other books, don't get surprised. In other books, they use equilibrium arrows, which are half arrows. In other books, they use complete arrows facing in opposite directions. These are called reversible arrows. So we have methanoic acid, acetic acid, which is ethanoic, lactic acid, citric acid. So generally, organic acids fall under what we call weak acids. So when we look at, I can give an example of dissociation of methanoic. There's no need for you to master the formula. You get to know all these formulas as you progress. So this is methanoic acid. So when methanoic acid dissociates, of course, there will be the hydrogen ions. So we use the double arrows, hydrogen ions, and then we will have the H here, the C, then O negative. So that is a partial dissociation. So it's this acid that is becoming this, that is becoming the positively charged. Then the rest becomes negatively charged. So what is important here is the arrows. The moment you see those arrows, it means this is a weak acid, partial dissociation. All right. So we can now move and look at what is called basicity of an acid. So basicity of an acid is basically the number of hydrogen ions that are produced by one molecule of an acid. When one molecule of an acid is dissolved, the number of hydrogen ions that is going to be produced is what is referred to as basicity of an acid. It will make more sense when we look at the example or the examples in the table below. So the number of hydrogen ions that are produced by one molecule of an acid. So in the examples here, we have hydrochloric acid. So when one molecule of this dissociates, you will notice that there is a one here. One hydrogen ion is produced when one molecule. So that one is what is known as the basicity of an acid. If you look at sulfuric acid, when you balance the equation, you find that there is a two. So that two becomes the basicity of an acid. Phosphoric acid, there's a three, meaning that three is the basicity of an acid. So the number of hydrogen ions produced by one molecule. So the emphasis is one molecule. It should just be one molecule of that particular acid. The number of hydrogen ions produced by one molecule of an acid is what is referred to as the basicity of an acid. All right. With that being discussed, we can now look at what is called a dilute acid and what is called a concentrated acid. I can give an example of sometimes we take concentrated drinks when you haven't diluted your juice. It is concentrated. When you add water to it, you're trying to neutralize the sweetness. So we can relate when we are looking at a concentrated acid and a dilute base. So when you're looking at an acid which is concentrated, what characterizes an acid is the number of hydrogen ions present. So an acid with a higher concentration of hydrogen ions, when you have a higher concentration of hydrogen ions, that acid is known as a concentrated acid. There is too much of hydrogen ions in the solution, it means that that acid will be concentrated. And then the opposite is when you have a low concentration, when the number of hydrogen ions is very low, meaning there is more of the water and less of the hydrogen ions, that will be referred to as a dilute acid. So what characterizes the concentration of an acid is the number of hydrogen ions present. When you have more hydrogen ions, it means that your acid is concentrated. When you have less hydrogen ions, your acid is dilute. Physical properties of an acid. How do we physically identify that this is an acid? What physical properties are we going to use to identify that this is an acid? So if you work in the lab, you're given two containers, two beakers, both containing colorless solutions. And then they ask you, which container, which beaker is having an acid, or which beaker is contained with an acid? It's very difficult to tell because both beakers have a colorless solution. And you'll be tempted to say, this is water. Sometimes you can try to smell and you do not get the smell. So it's very difficult to identify. So how do we know that this is an acid? If we're going to test, we can test using something that is, of course, it should be edible. I can give an example of a lemon. If you test a lemon, we can tell that there is the presence of an acid because of the sour taste. When we get a sour taste, it means that there is a presence of an acid. It's like sour milk. Sour milk, there is always that sour taste. So we are able to tell that there is a presence of an acid in this. Sometimes we can get this acid and put it on a cloth and then observe the reaction. So if you get the acid, you put it on a cloth, give it some time, you find that the cloth is eaten. That is known as corrosion. So an acid is corrosive in nature. So it is able to corrode certain materials. If we can't use that, we can use a pH meter. We'll soon talk about the pH scale. A pH meter, when you get a pH meter, you dip it in an acid, it will always give you a pH less than 7. So a pH is just an instrument. We'll talk about this. You can dip it in a beaker. You have a beaker, you dip it there, and then it will be able to read on the digital screen and show you a particular number, but that number that you will get will always be less than, will always be less than 10. I mean, will always be less than 7, sorry. So an acid will always have a pH which is less than 7. We have the identity test of an acid. The identity test of an acid is now where you can fully identify an acid. So if you give me two containers, both containing colorless solutions, and I want to know which one is containing an acid, so I will use what we call a litmus paper. Now, this litmus paper should be blue. So get a blue litmus paper, of course, which is damp, moisturized a bit, and then dip it in an acid. Dip it in an acid. It will change from blue, it will become red. The moment there is that change, this confirms that what I am dealing with or what is contained in this beaker is an acid. So this is known as the identity test of an acid. So we have come to the end of our session today. We will continue in the next video, and we're going to talk about the chemical properties of an acid. Chemical properties of an acid. If there are any questions pertaining to what we have talked about in this video, feel free to ask the questions in the comment section. And if there are any topics that you want to be covered, feel free to comment those topics in the comment section and they will be attended to. It has been your host, Mr. Monsa, your chemistry tutor. Until next time.